Is she not here? I guess not. But good evening. I'm Assemblywoman Nathalia Fernandez from the 80th Assembly District, and you are at the D'Essence Show. Get in line.
What's up, guys? It's your girl, D'Essence, right here on the D'Essence Show. Thank you once again for tuning in each and every week. I have a beautiful female on set with me, and we're going to get into so much. I can't wait to start speaking with her. This is her first time here on the D'Essence Show, and I'm happy that she's here. I want to welcome the Assembly Woman of 80th Assembly District, Miss Nathalia Fernandez.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. You look beautiful. I love your hair, as always.
Thank you. I'm checking in the camera, making sure the fluff is all right.
No, the fluff, there's no fluff.
Sometimes you need a boost.
How's your day going so far?
Day's been good. It's been a long day. Started early visiting elementary school. Mm-hmm. It was community builder day or community member day, community leader day. That's what it
was. Okay. It's okay.
And it was great. I spoke to a pre-K class and tried to explain to them what I do as an assembly member and, you know, community leader. And it was adorable.
That must have been really interesting because, like, we spoke behind scenes and you were saying that you spoke to numerous age groups.
Yes, because I've gone to high schools many times and, you know, it's easier to talk to high school kids. I mean, I feel like I can relate better to them, or they like to hear from a young elected official like me. So in those cases, you know, it's great to just hash it out, talk real and whatever. But with the kids, you really gotta like break it down so they understand in a way that's, you know, easy for them. So it was cute when I walked in, the teacher had explained how elections work, so they knew how I got my job. Okay. And they had like the kids had post-its on their shirts saying I voted because they did a little mock election. What's the better animal, cat or dog? So there was a whole bunch of kids, cats are better, dogs are better.
So it was really cute. And what group is, like, what age group is that? Is that like three?
Yeah, 3 to 4 pre-K.
And they're so smart, but it is like a... You have to find the fun in explaining exactly what it is.
Yeah, like I was trying to explain laws, and I'm like, okay, what are rules that mommy says you have to follow in the house? Oh, I have to put my shoes away. I was like, okay, well, example for the world, or at least New York State, a rule that we have that you all know is you must buckle your seatbelt. That rule is a law. So explaining it like that made them understand. And they're like, well, I think a rule should be that we need to have a purple sign for our thing. Like,
Look, cute ideas.
Yeah, they got it.
I love that.
But it was adorable.
That is a beautiful way to start the morning. Yeah. I just want to congratulate you on all the work that you've been doing.
Thank you.
And that you actually have put in to fulfill the position you're in. I respect you.
I wanted you
to be the first one on set with me as a female. Because, you know, I've interviewed many people, but you're the first of your nature. And I also want to get, like, one-to-one. Like, I want you to share to the viewers what you've done for the Bronx community. But I also want to do, like, your growing up and how this all became. So, maybe we can do it like a storyline.
Okay.
Talk to me, Nathalia. Where are we from?
Yeah. My family comes from Cuba and Colombia. Mm-hmm. My father immigrated from Cuba when he was about 10. My mother from Colombia when she was 15. Mm-hmm. And they both came to the Bronx, met in the Bronx, started the family here in the Bronx in my district. But I'm from a big family, one of 6 kids.
Oh,
so
wow.
By the time I was about to be born, we did move to Rockland just to have space for the family.
Okay.
But soon enough, you know, family came back to the Bronx. And I've been working in public service for about 10 years now. Mm-hmm. And I really never intended to get this way or this far or in this field. I just happened to, you know, be kind of in the right place, right time. Mm-hmm. I graduated from Hofstra University with a degree in public relations.
Nice.
And I overheard that there was going to be an election. And, you know, somebody that knew somebody that I knew was running for state assembly for the 80th. And I got involved in their campaign because I really believed in the change and vision that they had for the district and really to just improve the neighborhood, you know, better quality of life, make sure schools are better funded, you know, streets are maintained, things like that. So in volunteering 2012, that candidate ended up winning, and I came aboard staff as district representative, office manager, really every hat in the office that you could think of.
How exciting.
It was, and it was an amazing learning experience because, you know, I really learned how the city functioned and how the state can facilitate and really how the state functions with government, with funding, with everything. So to learn everything as a staffer then, I think, completely paved my way to be where I am now. But I wasn't always a staffer in the Assembly office. I did work for Governor Cuomo for a year.
I read that, yeah.
Which was pretty awesome. And at the time, it was the biggest.
That's huge.
Yeah, it was like the biggest opportunity of my life.
Wasn't
my God.
Intimidating?
It was. It was so intimidating because, you know, with my position as chief of staff, I mean, not intimidating. I'm not even going to say that word. It was just flattering, I guess.
Okay. No, definitely. Yeah. But it could be overwhelming, too. Like, do you come from a family of politics?
No.
Look
I mean,
that.
My family, of course, they have their comments. Every family loves to talk it at the kitchen table, but never has my family been involved in local elections and campaigns, you know, rallies or anything like that.
Was this something you were always into, like even as a teenager, just always like...
A little bit, yeah. I was always like a rah-rah with something. I grew up dancing, so I didn't do sports or anything like that, but, you know, being that natural cheerleader to my family and to anything that
Definitely.
I love to do... Well, it's just exciting for me and, you know, being in or having my degree in public relations starting from a young age, I always had like a little inkling. I need to do something in the spotlight. I don't know what I need to do. I'm so shy, but same time I want to be involved in, you know, these bigger conversations and you know, being, I guess, an assemblywoman working as locally as I do kind of gave me that opportunity. And it's great, because I'm so in touch with my district and my community that when I'm able to make like a small little difference by just getting a little bit of funding or getting somebody to give attention to something that, you know, anybody thought would have been forgotten, it's really satisfying. And it's
how should I say this? What made your family come to the Bronx? Why was the borough the Bronx had chosen?
Because
then you left and came back too.
Yeah, well, my father never left the Bronx. Family business has always been in the Bronx.
Okay.
So as my other family from Cuba, Colombia continued to come to this country, we all resided in the Bronx. And it was my home away from home. Every summer, every weekend, I was here. And right after college, that's when I moved here full time. And
what age were you here from? What age did you come to New York?
Well, I was born in New York.
You was born in New York.
Yeah,
okay.
I've always been a New Yorker.
Awesome.
But yeah, like 19. Was when I came back here. I'm 31 now, so.
Oh my God, you're such a baby.
I feel like a grandma. I'm getting these gray hairs here.
I mean, what is it to be female in this environment, dealing with so many different personas, egos, fighters?
Yeah,
men?
I mean, I want to say it's tough because it is. You know, this is a man's world as history has written it, you know, politics and government. So breaking into the scene and, you know, bringing my chair to the table, like, I'm here to listen to, and I want to have my say, too. Like, I will say there's been times that I've had to speak twice, you know, make sure I'm heard.
Good for you.
And if anything, yeah, it's just a little hard because you got to put in double work.
Yeah.
But thankfully now, I think we're in a place that, you know, a woman's voice is absolutely welcomed and wanted and looked for. So
even when they
it's
say
gotten,
no.
Yeah. So it's gotten better.
All right. Because there's a few things I was reading up on, and I also was speaking to your people. So we have a bill for mental health, which I found extremely important and very interesting. And it allows the students to take off a day for mental or behavioral stress or...
Any time that the student needs, whether to seek help or to really... decompress mental health day off, same way you take a physical health day off if you know you're aching or something.
Right.
You may need a day off to recompose, you know, regroup.
Yeah. No, I definitely agree with that. What I know in the workforce, we're supposed to be entitled to mental health days. Why is that not being practiced?
There's still a stigma that we're fighting everywhere. And as I like that, you know, in constant conversations, we're having the conversation about the stigma. But the stigma, I still think it is there, that people could feel embarrassed or they feel weak that, you know, I shouldn't have to take a day off. Like, I can push through this. I can do this. And, you know, the encouragement is good. But at the same time, you know, you need to listen to your body, listen to your mind when you just need to take a break. And students, that's such a difficult time in their lives, you know, when they're coming of age, when they're trying to figure out what they want to do with their future, you know, aside from whatever's happening at home, it's a very, very stressful time. So along with that bill to allow students to have mental days off, mm-hmm. I also have another bill that would retrain staff and administrators, guidance counselors, and more to understand the different, I guess, mental ailments that okay. that might be, you know, unknown, I guess, to some.
I'm interested to know, like, how would you put it together, like, the policy of it? Because, you know, people can take advantage of that. And I think that's why people are not really honoring the Mental Health Day.
Well, we have a lot of partners involved in this, not just okay. me and you know, the co-sponsoring senator that says this is the new law. You know, we're speaking with Department of Education. We're speaking with many advocacy groups that address suicide in youth to get their input on it. You know, we want this to be a bill that is not abused, that will work, mm-hmm. and only working with the professionals that are, you know, 150% focused in this field can give the proper guidance to how to implement it. So we've been working with Communal Life Inc., NAMI, the National Association of Mental Illness, to make sure that it's, you know, put together right.
That's beautiful. And you're also working with the unions, right?
Yes.
For better health care?
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm. That's been a fight that myself and a lot of members are, you know, on board for.
It's a continued fight.
Yeah, because this has been something that has been proposed for probably 10 plus years. And it's now that, you know, we feel we have a chance in getting it done because, I don't know if you know, but you know, the state assembly and the state Senate are now majority Democrat houses.
Okay.
So for many years, a lot of the progressive legislation that the assembly has put forward and passed died in the Senate because Republican leadership didn't want to, you know, allow it for a vote.
Right.
But thankfully, we got two majorities, and it's been such a monumental last session. We're getting ready for the next session in getting so much legislation that we've been dying to get done, finally done, like the housing laws, like criminal justice reform, hopefully soon now healthcare, and a lot of other matters. There's a long, long laundry list.
There is, and it takes years and years for it to. Mm-hmm.
And part of the time in finally accomplishing it is getting the public to understand and educate them as to why this is a problem and why we need a solution and why this is the solution. So every new, I guess, idea, you can expect a few years of fighting.
And we all, as human beings or as a community, we also need to be open for the resources. There's so many resources. I work in the South Bronx, too, for Community Board, too.
Mm-hmm.
And we have so many resources for our community, but people are just so naive to it.
They just don't know.
They just don't know. Some don't want to know. You can honestly say some people don't really care to know about what can help them.
That's happened. And some people, it's unfortunate that there's, I guess, a lack of trust in the resources out there. Yeah. But you know,
truthfully,
if we find the flaw in this one resource, then we can improve it. So I say go to it, you know, utilize what we have. And if you feel it needs to be improved, then we can absolutely work on that.
I love that you are working with women issues such
as,
I mean, we're talking about trafficking, rape. What was the other one? I think it was FMG.
The mutilation, female genitalia, genital.
Genitalia.
I know it was genitalia. The mutilation.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah, no, these are things that, again, it's been a long fought, battle, argument, but we're making big strides and finally getting these changes. Like in this last session, we changed the sexual harassment laws. There was a hearing that happened first time in 27 years to address sexual harassment within the legislature and the workforce in general.
Wow.
To better, punish those that commit these crimes. At the same time, we passed legislation that would benefit women's health, the Reproductive Health Act. Women's rights with the boss bill, meaning that your employer cannot ask what are, you know, your plans. So if a woman were to get pregnant, it's no business of the employer to, or he's not able to, decide to move you or terminate you.
Yeah. And that's usually a question. So what's the plan?
Yeah. Well, they have no say in it.
Yeah.
But also another important one for our health that, you know, these are things that I see in years past hasn't been taken seriously because there haven't been enough women in the room to show importance to it. One of them was giving tampons, free tampons in schools.
Yeah.
You know, that should be something that I think should be free everywhere. That's nothing. Absolutely. That's something that we can't control. So.
And I think that should also be issued to the ones that unfortunately are poor or homeless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure. And that's another one. In prisons, making we're looking to get legislation out, or it's been an idea between members, to not put a cap on how many sanitary products a woman incarcerated would have.
Absolutely.
Because right now there's a limit. You get 24 for the 24 tampons for the month. But every woman has a different flow. So how are you going to say this is all you're getting? Good luck if, you know, you run out. So, yeah, things like that we have to make sure, you know, you know, it's needed.
Is any of that personal towards you? I'm not trying to intervene, but, like, do you have, a personal, I don't know, gunning or desire to help the females that are dealing with sexual violence and rape, like, is it something that's been around?
It is, especially with, I guess, any trauma, sexual violence or physical, verbal violence, and tying to the mental health. Before I ran for office or anything, I volunteered with Communal Life Inc. In their Life is Precious program.
Okay.
And the Life is Precious program is an after-school program for adolescent Latinas, between ages like 10 and 16.
The crucial ages.
The crucial ages, you know, when they're coming of age, bodies changing, you know, responsibilities change in the home, they're changing in school, and unfortunately, Latinas have one of the highest suicide rates in, I guess, the United States or America or all that.
Yeah.
But I was a volunteer counselor, and, you know, my job was easy in a sense, in that I would be there and just talk with the girls, interact with them, you know, share ideas about things.
Yeah, to be a friend, too.
Yeah, to be some sort of support, you know, that they can just speak to and, you know, find some relief in a person that is not going to judge them, that's not going to rat on them, and just, you know, really wants the best for them. Yeah, so that kind of shaped my mind into the needs of what at least young Latinas need now in their adolescence, and then, you know, moving forward into young adulthood.
I have a very strong desire for the school curriculum to be changed and updated.
It does.
Yeah.
It needs to be updated and changed.
But reason why. Do they still have health classes or things to help you with that sort of nature?
I heard not all schools have that. That's not part of the curriculum.
Right.
Like that health is not necessarily mandated. But again, in the legislature, we're making changes to make sure that certain things are taught in schools, like Aaron's Law. We passed Aaron's Law this year to add to the school curriculums that students must be educated on what's consensual and what's not consensual. Ooh. And, you know, your danger zones or whatever.
Yeah.
Because sadly, you know, kids are not taught this and they're getting abused by whether teachers, guardians, something. They need to know what's right or wrong at an earlier age.
Definitely. Because, even to themselves.
Yeah.
There's a lot of sexual activity going on in schools that are not supposed to be happening.
Yeah. So
I've heard stories of individuals that work with DOE and just the things that comes up. You know, that they deal with. But you also have big priority that you would like to introduce a comprehensive bill, right, to study and prohibit the use of chemicals.
Yes, that's another one.
Products.
It's growing off of legislation that was passed and signed by the governor to have products labeled, menstrual products, pads and tampons, have on the label all the ingredients in there. Because we should know what we're putting into our body. But now, what are these ingredients? We know the name, but do we know what it really does or what it really is? So I'm introducing a bill that would study these ingredients and see what is dangerous, what's not, because a lot of times, these are carcinogens that we're just putting in our body thinking that it's helping us. But in a long-term study, you can see that it actually did long-term damage. So we need to see that what these chemicals, extra bleaches, fragrances, whatever, is actually doing to us.
Interesting. And you also fight for a pay difference of genders?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Okay.
We work hard, ladies, so we need to get paid fairly.
Now, what were you saying, that there's over 100 females in the assembly?
Oh, no. In the assembly right now, we have about 50 women. In the Senate, I think there's about 20. Don't count me on those numbers. But it is still the most that New York has ever had in the state legislature.
Yes.
So this is a big growth for us. And our speaker has said, I really hope it's 50-50. So the assembly has 150 members. We hope, you know, split 50-50, that is women. But it's been a great year, and 2018 was the year that all these new women had come. So I guess I am in that party. I ran in 2018, and I'm part of the wave of women that, you know, decided to throw their hat in the ring and have a seat at the table.
So what's your next, like, what's your goal? Like, what do you want to, how high do you want to go with this?
Oh, gosh.
Like, what's the highest level? Do you want to go all the way, like, running for president one day?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, it's maybe not impossible. Bronx, it's not impossible, but right now, my focus is my district, the Bronx. So yeah. If anything, maybe Bronxville president one day.
That would be so cool.
It'd be fun.
It'd be fun. It looks like it excites you more than stress or fear you a little bit. Not that you're supposed to not do things because of fear, but you don't seem intimidated. You seem ready for it.
I think I am ready. Yeah. I mean, again, I've been in this field behind the scenes and in front of the scenes, so I have a good idea and level of experience, I guess, in it. But, you know, I already did kind of represent the entire borough working for the governor, so
right.
I learned to love the Bronx more than I ever did. And, you know, to have that in my future wouldn't be bad.
Be great. What's your favorite thing about the Bronx?
The culture, how we're so different, the music. I love that we are the borough that had invented doo-wop and salsa and hip-hop, you know? Like, no other borough has done that.
And we have great history, too.
We do. I love Bronx history. Yeah. It's amazing.
What do you want to see the Bronx get to? Because, you know, we do still have a lot of work.
We do, and
it's
I would love
it's gotten better. I'm not taking nothing away.
It's gotten better. Some people will argue, you know, that's gentrification.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think
it's happening everywhere, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we have to protect the Bronx. You know, we want to make sure that Bronx residents are staying in the Bronx, that we're not being pushed out. But at the same time, we want to make sure that the Bronx is growing in a way that it will sustain itself, you know?
Yeah, we want it to be safe, too. Because it is a welcoming borough, like you said. So
it
is. So we want to continue that.
Yeah.
What is this? I was reading. What is this dog clipping or tail? What is it? Tail docking?
Tail docking and ear clipping.
Ear clipping.
Yes. So it's a business that people clip tails and dock ears for, honestly, cosmetic purposes, just to make the dog look a certain way. And I think that's cruel and inhumane.
How many people are actually doing that?
A lot of people. Yeah. Look at pit bulls. Pit bulls have their ears clipped. And
that's right.
Yeah,
I
so
never really...
unless it's for a medical reason or something life-threatening that, you know, you have to clip the ears, you know, because there's times that, you know, maybe the dog got into a fight and the ears are damaged, you got to clip the ears.
Right.
But yeah, that's really to just, you know, be a little
less
cruel
to
animals.
Yeah, definitely. So just for, I just want to show, like, certain things that we've done for the community. So allocated over or about $500,000. For the Prenus Clinic?
The Parnes Clinic. That one I'm very proud of because as soon as I, you know, enter office, I ran into specials. So as soon as I won, I was the working assembly member going up to Albany and all that. And mental health being my main focus, you know, upon entering, I found out that a clinic wanted to expand and it's super affordable mental health clinic. You can walk in, you don't need insurance, really like a $5 copay.
Okay.
And you can get any type service or person to talk to anything. So I was able to get $500,000 so they can expand and, you know, further their services. So I'm very proud of that.
I love that.
Same times I got money allocated to our local libraries. I love
yes.
our libraries.
Yes, and I wanted to speak to you about that because a lot of libraries are closing.
And sad. Very sad.
What's your thought on that? And why are they closing?
I don't know the reasons why they would close. Mm-hmm. I mean, I imagine maybe no foot traffic. Because
everything is right on the palm of your hand.
Exactly.
Now.
But our libraries are so needed. You know, not everybody has a computer at home. Not every book is that accessible. And
it's a great resource to have in your community.
Yeah. And the programs that the library provides are so important to many people. Yeah. Like, you know, there's English learning classes. There's writing classes.
And they're all free, too.
Yeah. So the library is, you know, a hub of so much opportunity that's for free that I think we really need to protect and keep in our communities. Because for generations, they've been helping us. And why stop now?
Yeah, I don't know what it would be to not have a library in your community. Seriously. Yeah. Thanksgiving turkey giveaways you do?
Yes, 'tis the season.
Yes.
Thankfully, I get turkeys donated to me that I'm able to then donate out to the community.
Good stuff.
So it's a great time of year that you're able to do that small gesture and just giving, you know, a free meal.
How do you spend your holidays?
With family. Yes.
Nice.
Again, my big family, we all come together and it's fun. You know, we Thanksgiving, all the women are cooking in the kitchen. Ooh, we just love
I can't wait.
Christmas time, my brother's birthday is the 24th. So we have a Noche Buena party. Nice. And it's nice. Yeah, I love the holidays with my family.
What do you do? Who are you when you take that blazer off at the end of the day?
I'm a couch potato. No.
Yes. Okay.
Well, sometimes. But really, I can't sit still anymore. This life has put my mind in a place that if I sit at home all day, I'm like, okay, I missed something. Yeah. I need to do something.
That's the drive in us to keep it going,
But I put that energy towards, you know, little things, errands, cleaning my house, going to the gym, you know, having lunch with a friend or something just to make sure I caught up.
Yeah.
So
I love it. I look forward to seeing you grow and grow and grow.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much for being here and sitting with us and telling us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, this is fun.
I'm very proud of you, and just keep doing the damn thing.
I will.
Female.
Yes.
Let our viewers know where they can reach you.
All right, well, my office is located at 2018 Williams Bridge Road, Bronx, New York, 10461. The office phone number is 718-409-0109. And I can be reached via email at fernandezn@nyassembly.gov.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Also, I'm sorry.
Anything really
in
quickly?
Social media, Instagram and Facebook, find me on there as well. Twitter, Fernandez4NY. Follow me. Keep up to date with what I'm doing, what we're working on. Anything and everything, please feel free to reach out at any time.
Thank you, Nathalia.
Thank you.
I love the name, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you for being here.
My pleasure. Hey, I'm Nathalia Fernandez, State Assembly Member for the 80th Assembly District. I'm here on the DSN Show. Get in line.
Bring that beautiful lady here. Great to see you.
Hi, how's your mom?
She's great. You look beautiful. You guys look like celebrities.
No, we are. This is my prom date. This is the Bronx prom. This is what we do. This is like our high school prom, but except we're celebrating the entire borough of the Bronx.
You guys look so in love. Oh. So fresh to death.
Oh, this is the way we. This is what it is to be from the Bronx. It means to have long-lasting love and resiliency and celebrating our flavor, our swag, and who we are and all of our accomplishments.
Oh, Mr. Ruben Diaz, Jr., Bronx Borough President. How are you feeling tonight?
I'm feeling excited. I'm so happy that the weather is
gorgeous.
Been good to us, and tomorrow is our finale with the parade and the festival as well as the concert. But tonight we celebrate those three inductees, Regina Spektor, Carolyn Porco, and Iran the Blade Barkley. So I'm excited. I'm excited for them. I'm happy for them.
Yes.
They've done amazing work throughout their lives. It's taken them through amazing travels. And they embody everything that we are as a Bronx and our success. And it's good to see that so many Bronxites came out looking all dapper and sharp. And we're going to have a great party. It's the best party of the year.
Yes, how are you feeling tonight?
I'm feeling well, thank you. It's always great. The Bronx Bowl is always a great event. Yes. All the honorees. It's a fun night. It's a great night for the Bronx.
Yes. I'm very excited. Thank you for everything you're doing.
Thank you. We're going to have
looking
fun.
Are we for this mayor still?
No, we're not going to do politics tonight. We're just we're gonna keep it all about the Bronx
today. Sorry, guys. No problem. Love you guys.
Good try.
Have a good night. That was Mr. Ruben Diaz, my buddy. We do this every year, so it's a blessing to be here tonight. Evening, we are here at Pelham Split Rock event for 2019 Bronx Ball, and I came across a very important friend of mine who's also the executive director of BronxNet, which is my new home that I'm so happy to be part of. I would like to introduce the Bronx's own Michael Nabe, right? Did I get the name right?
To Essence, I'm better now that I'm here with you. Get in line on the red carpet at the Bronx Ball. Happy, healthy Bronx Week. Exciting time to celebrate the arts, culture, and community during Bronx Week with Bronx Borough President Ruben Diaz Jr. and the Bronx Tourism Council and all these great people that are helping to build community and the honorees, people who grew up in the Bronx or lived in the Bronx and now have gone on to achieve national and international renown are being celebrated here and more.
And every year is just fascinating people. This year we have a scientist being honored.
Yeah, Carolyn Porco, she has worked with NASA, and she helped identify in terms of studying space, the rings of Saturn and what it's composed of, and some serious work. And she came from the Bronx, and it's a convergence of science and the arts and music with Regina Spektor, brilliant singer, songwriter, and musician, and of course, sports and athleticism. And Aran the Blade Barkley, championship boxer, grew up in the Bronx.
We have legendaries here. So I know you're here usually every year. How you feel this year? Are you nervous? Are you excited?
Both. Nervous, excited. The butterflies are flying. I just was on the Bronx River canoeing this morning with the Bronx River Alliance, and I saw the urban wilderness and wildlife, and now I see all the community coming out here to celebrate together. And we also can celebrate the Bronx Zoo. The Wildlife Conservation Society is being recognized here tonight at the Bronx Ball with the Bronx Tourism Award.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
It's so much to see in the Bronx, so much to celebrate, and I'm so glad that you're part of the BronxNet family, Descents.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for having me as family. Also, great to see you. You look great. Turn around a little bit. Do a little thing. And he always looks so sharp.
And Bronxborough historian is here.
Oh, come on. Let's talk. Thank you, Max.
I love it. Introduce yourself. Give us a little history.
All right. Well, you know, once upon a time, there was a man who was born in Sweden, who came to the Netherlands, learned how to navigate a ship, retired, got married, and took some workers along with him, went along the ocean. In 1639, he came here. His name was Jonas Bronck, B-R-O-N-C-K. And ultimately, the Bronx is named for him. And if it weren't for him, none of us would be here.
I love it. Any fun facts about the Bronx that maybe we don't even know about?
There are a lot of things that people don't know about. For instance, how many people know that the Bronx produced two of the nation's founding fathers? Right.
Interesting.
Lewis Morris, who signed the Declaration of Independence, and Gouverneur Morris, who was one of the principal framers of the Constitution of the United States. In fact, he's the guy who wrote the various resolutions into a literary form. So the Constitution is written in Gouverneur Morris's style of writing.
What's your favorite thing about the Bronx?
I don't have any favorites. I love it all.
Can you let our viewers know what your name is again and what do you do?
Yeah, my name is Lloyd Ultan, and I am the Bronx Borough Historian.
Oh, I love it. You need to come on the Essence Show one day and visit me. Give us some fun facts and some great history about the Bronx.
I can give you lots of things. I mean, how many people in literature wrote about the Bronx in one way, shape, or form. How many the various events that have happened in the Bronx. And some of the old Bronx that is still around today that people can look at and enjoy and learn from.
Are we a resident of the Bronx?
I was born in the Bronx and have lived in the Bronx my entire life.
That's beautiful.
I'm a stick in the mud.
I love it. Thank you so much, and it was an honor meeting you today. God bless. Thank you. And there you have it. We'll be right back. The Essence Show on location here at 2019 Bronx Ball. Get in line.
How you feel? Come over here. Beautiful.
Thank you. What's your name again?
Nathalia Fernandez.
Oh, we're gonna let you say that because you sound beautiful when you say
it.
All right. So yeah, I do a show also on Bronx now.
Oh, cool. What's it called?
Yeah, the Essence Show.
The Essence?
The Essence Show.
The Essence.
Yeah, and I'm all about Latinas and women empowerment.
Nice. My kind of stuff.
Yeah, we should bring you on so we can chit chat.
Oh, I would love that.
Yes. All right, and we're back with another beautiful lady here of the Bronx. Introduce yourself to our viewers.
Hi, viewers. This is Assemblywoman Nathalia Fernandez from the 80th Assembly District. Just getting to the Bronx Ball, and I'm very excited.
You look beautiful. I love your dress.
Yes. Together, you know. No, I didn't. I went shopping for it.
How you feeling tonight?
I love the Bronx Ball. It's exciting. You know, Bronx Week is the time of year where we really show the best of what we got and, you know, celebrate our accomplishments and, you know, do it all together. So the finale, the ball, is always, you know, the best little cherry on top. Actually, no, that's the concert tomorrow on Mashulu Parkway in the 80th Assembly District.
Yes.
So come to the concert tomorrow on Mashulu.
Yes, definitely. Anything you want to talk about with your movement, the councilwoman?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm an assembly member. I'm the youngest woman in the state assembly right now. One of seven Latinas, the most that there's ever been. So this is an exciting time, you know, for young people and everyone else, especially women. And we're doing big things. You know, we're trying to protect our rights. New York did take the first step in doing so in passing the RHA, the Reproductive Health Act. And, you know, just trying to educate more people so the rest of the country can stick up for our rights, too.
I love it. There is a lot going on, and it's getting really tough for the females out here, but we're sticking together and we're fighting for our rights. What's your favorite thing about the Bronx?
The cultures. We are so diverse, and, you know, we have the best little, like, secret places, like restaurants, obviously. We have so many little tiny different restaurants. The history of the Bronx, you know, being the only main piece of the mainland of the United States. We have a lot of history, and just always fun to explore and learn new bits about it.
And it does just keep getting better.
Doing great. Yes.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you again.
Have fun.
We'll connect. We'll get some business cards so I can have you on the show.
Yes.
Take it easy.
You're a very unique individual.
Oh, I am?
Yes.
Well, you have a lot of bling, too.
Yes, I do. I love
sisters.
It. I love it.
Okay.
And even, you know, this is motivation, so I can get a blinged out microphone. We're here at 2019 Bronx Ball. And I'm here with actually one of the honorees who I think is astonishing to meet her right now because she's actually a planetarian, right?
A planetary scientist.
Planetary scientist. Sorry, guys. I'm excited. I would like to introduce Caroline Porco.
Porco.
Porco. Okay.
Name,
nice.
Name, yeah.
So is this your first time being honored?
With this kind of a thing, yeah. I thought, you know, stars on sidewalks and street signs on street posts is something that they did for movie stars. I didn't know they did it for nerds.
That's amazing. Yes. Scientists, how did this all begin?
Well, it began, in fact, I grew up around here, and it began when I was a little girl, and I just was very captivated by I was very curious about things, and I gravitated towards science, and I liked the fact that it was a way to find out what was absolutely true.
Right.
You know, it's not what my parents said, what the church said, what the president said, what anybody said. You could actually just practice a certain method to get at the truth. And that's very powerful. In fact, it has enabled the progress of human culture. So it's really very, very essential that people, if not everyone's got to be a scientist, but they should understand what the practice is about.
And you said you're from the Bronx. How was it growing up here? And how was receiving an award?
Okay, so I have a lot of really fond memories of growing up in the Bronx. And you know, walking the streets of the Pelham Bay section with my girlfriends when I was a young teenager. We had our transistor radios by our ears. You guys, you probably don't even know what a transistor radio was. But when we would just be walking the streets, you know, like patrolling,
right,
you know how young
right,
girls do
right.
this? We're all wearing the same kind of outfits and waiting for Beatles songs. It's just, it was good. And I've realized over the years that there were a lot of really good, warm, hardworking people in my neighborhood. And you know that iconic image of New Yorkers
right.
in the early summer evenings, sitting on their stoops and, you know, just talking to the neighbors as they go by. And you know, that is the grist of a community.
Right.
And I've lived in various places around the country. That doesn't happen anywhere else. It's kind of unique to New York, it seems. So, I don't know. That's part of me. That whole thing about that's what a neighborhood should be like.
How did you be a female scientist?
Well, in the beginning, it was. I don't know, there's a lot of us now, but I grew up with four brothers. I always was around males. I was always fighting with males. Really, I mean, I had no problem fighting with males and saying, you know.
Well, it actually built you then.
Huh?
It built you up.
It built me up, really. I was ready. I was prepared.
Nice. What's the most interesting thing you can share about what you do?
What I do? Okay, so we spent Well, God, there's so many interesting things. Really, I've been so lucky. Well, one of the things we found with the Cassini mission, and I was a leader of the imaging team on the Cassini mission, one of the things we found was that one of its moons, a small moon no bigger across than England, has, and you know, it's cold out there, so on the outside it's all ice. All the moons are like that, but under the ice shell there's a global ocean. That ocean has organic materials in it, and it is salty like the Earth's oceans, and it even has evidence of hydrothermal activity. And in the hydrothermal zones on the seafloor of Earth, there's lots of life. So we are all very excited about the possibility that maybe this moon has life, and some of us are agitating for another mission to go back.
Oh my God, God bless and congratulations, and I can't wait for that.
Well, it might be a while.
Thank you so much for talking with us.
Oh, you're
and congratulations again.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Have a great night. Okay. Thank you. We'll be right back. Gina Spector here. She's one of the honorees for 2019.
How are you today?
I'm great. I'm very excited.
I feel the energy coming from you about all the excitement that you have.
Well, I love all things Bronxy, so.
I like that word.
Yeah.
Are you from the Bronx?
Yeah, well, as much as I could be. I came here as an immigrant. Actually, my family and I came here as refugees from the Soviet Union, but this was our first home in New York, so in America.
How was your growing up? You're living here.
It was really special. I felt very at home even before I spoke English. I kind of felt embraced and taken care of. I think that it's a very community loving place.
What part of the Bronx were you in?
Bridge.
Really?
Yeah.
I used to live not so far from there.
Good. We were neighbors. Yes, we probably smiled at each other in the street. That was one of the things that was actually really amazing to me about coming to America. In Russia, you have a lot of passionate people, and you know, obviously people are just people. Good people are good people everywhere, but culturally people really didn't smile a lot. So it was like when we got to the Bronx, it was like even people you didn't know in the street were just so friendly, and everybody was smiling to each other, and it was really like, oh, I like this.
Why the Bronx? How did you hear about the Bronx in Russia?
Well, we didn't hear about the Bronx in Russia. What happened was we went through this kind of long immigration process. First, we went to Austria, then Italy, and then finally we got permission to come into the United States. And we went and stayed with our aunt and uncle, who had come here about a decade before us. Okay. And then when we were looking for a place to live, my parents, just like every other Russian, went to visit Brooklyn, because that's where everybody is, Brighton Beach, you know. And they just really, really wanted to experience, I don't know how to put it, they wanted like to feel America. They didn't want to like move to Russia, you know, from Russia. So they were looking for another place, and at that time, the local synagogue in Kingsbridge opened the Russian resettlement office, and we were, I think, one of the first three or four families in the Bronx that were Russian at that time. Yeah, we were on like the cover of the newspaper.
There's a celebrities are ready.
Exactly, I was like playing handball in front of our building, and we were on the cover of the local newspaper, and now I'm here.
How you feel about Sarah? Are you excited?
Oh yeah. I think, oh, I can't believe it. You know, it makes me so happy. It makes me extra happy for my family and for my parents. And it's just such a beautiful thing that they did this cool thing of moving us to the Bronx. And look, yeah, it's so special. Yeah.
You are very special. Thank you for joining us on the D. Austin Show. Hopefully we can meet again.
Yes. Thank
you. Nice blessings and congratulations.
Thank you. Mutual.
Thank you. She's so pretty. Thank you. We'll be right back. Can we just do a little chat real quick?
Of course. Why not? I like the chat.
So we're back. We're here at the 2019 Bronx Ball, and I have a boxing legend, Iran Barkley's here.
Hey, that's right, the best one in the house. That's right.
I love your suit.
Thank you. My wife picked it out.
Did she?
Yeah.
And your boxing glove?
My gloves, yeah. I didn't want to wear all my chains, so I said, I'll wear one, you know, because the wife was like, no, you're not wearing all of those. I said, well, why? I want them.
That's true, right?
She said, nah, you'll take one or the other. I said, all right, I'll take one.
How do you feel to be an honoree tonight?
I feel great, you know what I'm saying? I mean, this is like a dream come true, you know what I'm saying? I just wish my mom was here.
She's here.
Yeah, she is. She definitely is. Her and my two sisters, they here, you know, but it was good, you know what I'm saying?
How is your life here in the Bronx?
My life is fine here in the Bronx, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I came a long ways, you know, to do this thing. And as I was doing boxing and everything and coming up in the days and the years, I seen from bad to good, you know what I'm saying? I was one of those bad guys, you know what I'm saying? But I made it good,
That's right.
And I came back to the neighborhood to, you know, inspire some of these young kids to, you know, you don't got to pick up a gun and a knife and run around shooting people and bam, bam, bam. But, you know, hey, you know, it is what it is.
How was the boxing career?
Boxing career is great, you know, except for only when Sugar Ray Leonard didn't want to fight me. Or, you know, I got to fight two of the legends, but I mean... I didn't get the other two. The other two that had the money, the real money,
right.
Marvin Hagler and Sugar Ray Leonard, you know, they were scared of me. They were scared to fight me, you know what I'm saying?
We need to make that happen.
Oh, man, I wish you could make it happen, boy, you know. But now I got my eyes set on a higher guy that's really good in the boxing game. He's a good fighter. He's a good boxer. He's a good puncher. But I don't think he can punch me out, though.
Who is it?
Deontay Wilder. I want to beat him up. I want to beat him up for the last hurrah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, they make that Deontay Wilder. Yeah, I want you to know, Deontay, I'm telling you now, I'm coming to get you. You beating up everybody, so you need a real guy to fight like me.
Oh, you talk a lot of smack on the Diaz show. I love it.
Oh, man.
You got to tell him, get in line.
Get in line, boy. That's right. Get in line, Deontay Wilder. After you finish that last fight you're going to have, I'm coming to get you.
It was a pleasure meeting you and speaking with you.
Thank you.
God bless and congratulations.
Thank you.
Nice meeting you.
Thank you for having me. So I'm Rafael Salamanca. I'm the council member for the South Bronx. And I'm really excited to be here. You know, this is Bronx Weeks, where we get to show off the best of the Bronx. And we kind of wrap it up. Well, this is a pre-wrap up. We wrap it up with a gala honoring, honoring individuals who are from the borough of the Bronx, who have made a big name for themselves, whether they're scientists, whether they're athletes, or whether they're architects or whatever the case is, and we honor them. But what's best of this event is that we get together as a borough, you know, we wear one of our best fine dresses or fine outfits, and we get together and we get to really interact with one another. And I think that's needed in the borough of the Bronx. There's a lot of, you know, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of development happening. There's a lot of activities that's coming to the borough of the Bronx. And it's important that we as elected leaders and just, you know, individuals from the borough of the Bronx can get together as one on this beautiful evening in Split Rock in Pelham. In the Pelham Parkway district of the Bronx, and enjoy each other's company.
What's the Bronx mean to you? You grew up in the Bronx, right?
Yeah, yes, you know, I'm a Bronx kid, born and raised in the Bronx, never left, you know, a big Yankee fan, And now I'm raising my family there, and I think I have the best job in the world, where I am representing the district that I was born and raised in. And I'm going back and I'm addressing the wrongs that have been ignored for decades. Whether it's parks in my district that have been ignored, whether it's schools that have been ignored, whether it's streets that have been ignored, or whether there's a certain area that there is missing lighting. You know, I'm ensuring that I'm working with my local stakeholders and addressing those issues and improving our quality of life.
What's your favorite thing about the Bronx?
There's many things. I mean, if you walk around my district, 90% of all my parks have been redone. You know, the restaurants that we have in the borough of the Bronx, but just the beauty, exactly what the Bronx brings. You know, but I think one of the best things about the Bronx is that, you know, this young Puerto Rican kid from the South Bronx never left, went to school in the Bronx, you know, worked in the Bronx, and now he's representing his community in City Hall, the Bronx.
Yes. Thank you so much for being here, for all the work that you do. I see a lot of what you do, and thank you for making the difference and staying humble as well. Are you excited to be here tonight?
I'm excited to be here today, and you know, I'm with my beautiful wife, and we're just gonna have a great time.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Right, you. Be good. We'll be back on the D. Austin Show on location, 2019 Bronx Ball. President office for inviting us, the D'Essence Show, to be on location to do interviews, red carpet, eat some good food, drink, hear the amazing music in the back. Yes, thanks to all the honorees that have come out tonight to share their talents and their achievements. I want to thank the Bronx for being a great community. We look beautiful tonight. Much continued success. Stay tuned. Bronx taking over. Bronx BX strong. Get in line, your girl D'Essence, right here on the D'Essence Show.
Hey guys, so that was such a pleasure of having Assembly Woman here on set with The Essence. I'm always honored and privileged to have individuals as herself here, basically using my platform to let the community know what she's doing for us and the resources out there that we can use and take advantage of. So follow her, let her know what you guys think or need in the Bronx so we can make it happen. Woman empowerment is always important to have and broadcast here. So I was very proud to have her. Hopefully we'll bring her back into 2020 and see what's going on and what bills have been passed. Also, I just want to welcome myself back. I just came from LA. If you guys know me or don't know me, there's been some time that I've been wanting to go out there to network and just hang out and see what it's about. LA has always been something I've seen on TV, never thought of actually going out there. So it was kind of special going out there, having a girls trip for a few days, getting away. Sometimes you just need to like get away from the everyday hustle. And I was feeling a lot of energy in the last 3 weeks. And I said, I think it's time for me to just pick up and go. I actually didn't let anyone know I was leaving. It's kind of spur of the moment. But sometimes you got to live on your toes, literally, and just head out to do what you want to do. And I'm thankful. It was a great trip. It was a great getaway. I was able to get some sun. I was also able to see what LA was like, what Cali's like. I was brought up in New York. I haven't gone to too many places, but I'm trying to get more into traveling because I just have the freedom to do so. So why not? Cali was a fresh air than I needed in my life. The weather is absolutely beautiful. I do feel that it was a little overrated. I think I expected a little more of something that I maybe missed out on, or maybe wasn't the season for it. But it was definitely something that I took in. The freedom that came along with it. I hiked. I realized how fearful I am of heights. And I overcame them and actually walked down canyons and made it to the side of California and Hollywood. And it was just amazing. So if you guys can head out and visit Cali, it's a great experience. I plan to go back and go to the other side to experience that. Venice Beach was dope. Santa Monica Pier was very pretty. Hollywood was interesting. Kind of reminded me of like a Times Square-ish, a little upscale maybe. But it was a great time. Also, it is holiday season, so please remember to love each other up and don't stress gifts so much. Stress the time and the quantity that you're spending with your family and loved ones. Also, if you need a time out, take your time out. There's nothing wrong with taking a break. As I was speaking with my last guest, sometimes we feel like we always have to be going, 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 but sometimes you really do need a mental health day, and there's nothing wrong with that. I think we all need the time to kind of rejuvenate ourselves and just get a clear mind and get back to the hustle. All right, guys? So don't forget to follow me on Real Ladies Real Talk at gmail.com. You can email me there. Also, Miss The Essence 1 on Instagram and Facebook, The Essence Romero. Please stay tuned. If you guys have any suggestions, recommendations, or you want to come on, just email me or hit me up on the DM, and you'll be here on The Essence Show. If not, you better get in line. Have a good night, guys.
The line.
That's the only thing you don't do. Don't you can skip line. It, you can get in line, wait on line.
What up, y'all? This is Chris Rivers, Dragons Up, straight from the Bronx, New York. You know we at The Essence.
Bright sky.
Or.
Get in line.